There it is. We do have a really good agenda. And if you were here in February and you liked the program, you will love this program. And first up is Kirk Hively. And remember last time people found a few spelling errors in this chart? And I don't think that's going to happen this time. I checked it. I strive for perfection. And based on the fact that I've not received any complaints, I have achieved my goal. So, Kirk, anything you want to say about this?
It's just that I
Here,
was
you can
at the
hold it.
no, so thank you. I'm going to try and be lively. This presentation's not all that lively. It's kind of annoying. I was with the Albuquerque Chamber Club over there for quite a while, and they had a tour, and I was able to get off work one day and sit down. And it's just a tiny little museum in downtown Albuquerque, and I wish I had my uncle with the telephone company. Explain some of the stuff we're looking at. It was fun to walk around. We got a couple flowers in there just to wander. So enjoy it.
And thanks to Kirk. And I took particular interest in this program because I am a telephone guy. I worked 3+ years for AT&T, Bell Laboratories, Western Electric, Nokia, Lucent, whatever. So like I say, I took special interest in this, and let's go with it. I don't have a test, but I do have a little bit of a quiz. Let's see, there should be a... How many of you remember seeing something like this, maybe in your house or your grandparents' house? In one set of our grandparents, there was one of these, and I think it just stayed there. It never got replaced until they moved on. And then, major upgrade, okay? We had one of these in our cabin, our cottage, which is north of Port Huron, Michigan. And it never got replaced until the place was closed a few years ago. And it worked. And then onto, the Princess phone. Remember the Princess phone? Okay. And then what did we have? Oh, Touchstone. What a finger saver, huh? And of course, now that. The next one, this is A Day in the Life at Laos with Sherry Lee. Sherry, is there anything you want to say about this? Okay.
It was a truly beautiful day living the life of a Laotian, starting with the daily morning ritual of giving alms to the monks. For the people, it sets up their day for blessings. For the monks, it provides their nourishment for the day, along with providing the people an opportunity to be blessed in giving.
No, I messed up. What I'm trying to do is not display the taskbar. But
it was a truly beautiful day living the life of a Laotian, starting with the daily morning ritual of giving alms to the monks. For the people, it sets up their day for blessings. For the monks, it provides their nourishment for the day, along with providing the people an opportunity to be blessed in giving. When we had given all our rice, we stood back and observed, then stopped at the temple with additional provisions. This ritual is followed by a traditional Lao breakfast. Now it's time to shop in the morning market for the afternoon lunch in a Hmong village.
You can have that one.
The locals have no need for refrigeration, as fresh food is purchased daily in the morning market. And up the mountain we go to the Hmong village, where we are greeted by the village leaders and curious children. Some of our travel money has been used to install electricity, toilets, and water towers, paint interior and exterior of buildings, and build a school. The visit with the school was very special. Next stop was to meet their local shaman in her home. She also demonstrated how she makes moonshine and shared samples with us. Then an amazing treat. The village chief shared their New Year blessing dance. followed by a traditional village lunch. In the meantime, Chef Fred prepared a U.S. dish as a gift for the village leaders. He did a great job making shrimp scampi over wood fire. Kap jai lai lai.
Don't have my microphone. Yeah. I'm not in charge of lights. Who is?
Left them off. Turn them off.
Look, not quite yet. Not quite yet. I'm not ready.
It's up front here.
The next one is Arlene. Arlene, is there anything you want to say about the lake?
How many have heard?
Ooh. How many heard that? Here, stand close to me so the Zoomers pick it up here.
How many have heard of Mono Lake? Oh, okay, a few. So Mono Lake is on the border of California and Nevada, and so you would pass Yosemite heading towards Las Vegas. So that's where Mono Lake is. And Mono Lake is an ancient lake. It's about a million years old. And it's 65 square miles. And if you'd like, you can go swimming or boating. And it's very buoyant. We didn't go swimming at all. But we
can't get you near the water.
And it's 2.5 times the saltiness of the ocean. So, and what makes it so unique is it's self-contained. And so because it evaporates, the salt evaporates, and they have these really cool, they're called tufas, and they're large statues, not statues, but, you know, salt formations. And so anyway, that's Mono Lake.
And one other thing, it's a migratory oasis for millions of birds that stop there.
And I'm guessing if it's 2.5 times the salt of the ocean, it's pretty hard to sink. Let's take a look. What I'm trying to do is get rid of that Say bar. Nope. We're not ready for you yet. Well, I think you're going to have to bear with the.
Thank you.
Carrie, thanks a bunch. Boy, I found that to be really pleasant and relaxing until we got to the loud music. Our sound level's okay, front and back? Okay, everybody can hear. Good. The next one is Kevin May. Is Kevin here or Zooming? Oh, I sure did. I went right over it. You know, as I was sitting down, I thought, oh, I went over Kevin's program, but I was right on target, except for missing this one. What this is, Grace, are you via Zoom? No. I lifted this from a multimedia SIG of maybe 3 or 4 years ago, where they were challenged to come up with a program within 3 minutes. And it had something to do with humor or tragedy. So that's what this is. And Grace is not here, so she won't know I almost skipped it. Thank you. Oh. This is on, yeah, okay, it's on. I couldn't tell with the darkness, kind of hard to tell. Well, thanks to Grace, wherever she is. And don't tell her I almost skipped it. She'll never know. The next one is by Kevin. Is Kevin here? No, via Zoom. No, okay, well, we'll proceed right to it then. Thank you. How about a little bit? How about a little bit of light, just temporarily? Who's in charge of lights? If you know Kevin, you know that he travels now and then and does videos and still photography for several of ongoing clients that he has. And in his spare time, he'll do something like you just saw. And that was in San Diego, as I remember. So the next one, what's up?
Seeing if you have another USB port.
What's that do?
Light.
Oh, that's okay. No, I don't. I'm out of them. The next one is filler. Something I found. We showed a couple of videos on the Equine Voices. This is something I found on either their newsletter or their website. It has to do with, and I'm sure you've seen publicity in news about the wild horse roundups in BLM land, I think maybe Wyoming and Montana, maybe other states, Nevada. And it's very controversial. And this video is done by a person who proposes that it's not the horses that are the problem, it's the cows that are the problem. So there is no elephant in our room, and there is no cow in our room, but let's take a look at this.
Well, I've been coming out to the Red Desert for about 20 years, and this is about the worst I've ever seen out here in terms of things being pounded by livestock. This area is a checkerboard between federal land and private land, and it's all unfenced, it's all open range, and the cattle pretty much wander where they will. This looks like they've trucked in a bunch of hay to feed the cattle because there's just not enough for them to eat out here. it's pretty unusual to see cattle in the middle of winter in the Red Desert, but there are some places where they basically have it open to year-round livestock grazing. Most of the West is very arid. The vegetation's very fragile. The soils are very thin. The rainfall is very sparse. And cattle are ill-suited to arid Western landscapes. Yeah. These are animals that evolved in the boggy northern European forests of places like Poland and Germany. They're best suited to areas with high rainfall, lots of vegetation productivity, and they do very poorly in arid environments. So when you put them in arid environments and try and force that square peg into the round hole, then what you get is the cattle concentrating along streams, in river bottoms, in those areas that are the natural biodiversity hotspots of the desert. And the cattle get into those areas and concentrate their use there and mow down the vegetation and destroy the shrubs and completely disrupt the ecosystem because they're misfits. Ecologically, they're misfits. Cattle, they won't venture more than 2 miles from water. And anytime you provide water out in the middle of the desert like this, they concentrate around that water. And they create what's called a pyosphere. That's an area of denuded vegetation that surrounds the water feature. The interesting thing is that wild horses will forage 20 miles or more from water. And so they can take advantage of areas that haven't been grazed by cattle. And they also use different habitat types at different times of the year than cattle are using. That's where you find the healthy bunch grasses and the biological soil crusts in the areas where the vegetation isn't so beaten down. So they're avoiding competition by spatially segregating themselves in space and time. Certainly, the Bureau of Land Management has got a serious problem with the way it evaluates the impacts of cattle and sheep on public lands. It is basically authorizing overgrazing on purpose. Typically, on a grazing allotment, they're going to authorize 50 or 60% of the annual vegetation production to be removed by cattle and sheep. That leaves the other 50% for wildlife, like elk and mule deer, for wild horses, for grasshoppers, for mice, for insects, and then the grass plant has to survive to make it to the next year. No wonder we have such serious overgrazing problems when the BLM is authorizing overgrazing as a standard operating procedure. If you look at public lands ranching, taxpayers are shouldering an enormous burden to have the privilege of having private ranchers graze their cattle on public lands. The cost of a cow-calf pair for a month is $1.35 for a month to feed a cow and a calf on public lands. Contrast that to what it might take to feed a hamster. It would be more expensive to feed a hamster than the BLM charges for public lands ranchers to come out on public lands with their cattle. And if you look at private lands, and the federal government has done this in their own investigations, they found that on average, in Western states where the public lands ranchers are running cows on private lands, the average cost of a grazing lease is $22 an animal unit month. So basically, the ranchers are getting a huge subsidy. And that doesn't even count things like drought payments and other kinds of farm bill payments that these same ranchers are collecting. It's pretty fragile and pretty marginal for plants out here. It's alkaline soils, pretty dry, and so the plants are kind of hanging on by their fingernails. This would be a greasewood flat normally with salt bush, but most of the shrubs have been trampled to death by the cattle. During the winter period, there's nothing growing out here, and it's pretty tough for cattle to find enough to live on, and certainly if you've got the cattle that are hitting the winter range, then it's pretty tough for the wildlife to find anything to eat as well, so it's kind of an ugly situation. Cattle and sheep are fundamentally different ecologically than wild horses, and cattle especially are different. Cattle will concentrate in riparian areas at the most fertile, productive areas of the land, and they will stay there 100% of the time, concentrating their impacts at the most fragile, biodiverse, and important part of the desert ecosystem. Wild horses range over very large areas, so they spread their impacts out. It's a lot more like bison graze. And so ecologically, wild horses are a lot better of a fit for arid Western landscapes than livestock are for this reason. The Red Desert is a really ecologically important place to start with. It's really the last big stronghold for the sage grouse. It's one of the last really big, largely unfenced tracts of public land that's out there. So it has a lot healthier ecosystem than many parts of the American West. The fact of the matter is that there are thousands of wild horses in the Red Desert. The BLM is trying to zero out more than half of the herds in the Red Desert right now, even though it admits that all of those lands that it wants to zero out are already meeting the thriving natural ecological balance that the Wild and Free Roaming Horses and Burros Act requires by law. And that seems really hard to explain from a logical perspective, from a legal perspective, from a public interest perspective. But it all boils down to a consent decree that the federal government signed with the Rock Springs Grazing Association back in 2011. And the Rock Springs Grazing Association came to the Obama administration saying, we want you to reduce the wild horses because we own some of the checkerboard squares in this checkerboard of public-private partnership along the railway. And the wild horses are on our private checkerboard squares eating grass that we want our cattle to eat. And we want to do something about it. And the Obama administration said, well, if you sued us, then we would have to cut a deal with you, and we would have to reduce the horse herds. And so they did cut a deal. And that deal was to reduce the horse herds, but the Grazing Association was supposed to tolerate a certain number of wild horses that would wander onto their checkerboard squares because it's all open range, it's all unfenced, public and private, next to each other. The livestock industry likes to blame wild horses for damaging the range and ecological land health problems that are out there on public lands that often do exist. The problem is that wild horses are so radically outnumbered by livestock that it's kind of laughable to finger wild horses as the cause of the problem. If you look at just the public lands and you correct for the fact that wild horses are out there for 12 months of the year, whereas cattle sometimes are out there for only part of the year, about 30% of the time, they're out there all year. But the BLM counts the animal unit months, which is the measure that's one cow-calf pair for 1 month. And that equals one horse for 1 month. And if you look at it apples to apples, AUMs to AUMs, what you find is there are 14.8 AUMs of cattle in the wild horse states on public lands for every AUM of wild horses. So wild horses are outnumbered by cattle strictly on public lands based on their grazing intensity, 15-1. And if you think about wildlife in the West don't respect public land, private property boundaries. They wander everywhere. So if you're looking at the ecological impact of wild horses and cattle, maybe you ought to be looking at all the lands because all the lands are potentially wildlife habitat. At that point, you have at most, and this is probably an overestimate, but at most 100,000 wild horses in the West. And you have 18.5 million cattle in those same states. So you have 185 cows for every wild horse in the American West impacting wildlife. Are wild horses really a major problem for wildlife when you've got a non-native species called cattle that is leveling 185 times the ecological footprint? It seems unlikely. And that doesn't even consider domestic sheep, which are out there by the millions.
Well, like I say, that was kind of like filler, okay? I ran across it. I thought it was interesting. I learned something from it, and I hope you thought it was interesting also. And I was watching at the same time. I was thinking about swimming in water that's 2.5 times saltier than the ocean. And I thought, you know, I'm not sure I want to do that. And I did not see, you know, along the ocean shoreline, sometimes they'll have at the beaches and parks showers. I didn't see any showers at Mono Lake. There are no showers. It's confirmed, no showers there. And how do you get it off your body? You'd have to have a scraper. Okay, the next one is moving a historic house. And by Jean. And Jean, is there anything you want to tell us about this?
No, it's just the economy and the open media state has been encouraging our members. You're going to spend some time doing a video production. Why don't you do something that's a public service? And so that's what this is. They were getting ready. I thought they were just taking the first on this historic house. But you'll see it's quite different.
Well, thank you for your public service.
You've had the unpleasant experience of packing up everything you own and moving. When the Sanilac County Historical Society found that one of the oldest houses in Port Sanilac was to be torn down, they decided to move the whole house over 3 miles to the museum site.
The Bark Chaney House is important because it was one of the first homes built in Port Sanilac in 1853, and it was built on the site of the original Bark Chaney. In the, I believe, late 1700s, early 1800s, loggers came to this area, and they wanted the bark from the hemlock trees to tan their leather. So right on this spot, they built a bark shanty for shelter. They had a bonfire that would be going 24 hours a day, every day. So mariners out on the lake came to depend on it, on that fire, as an aid to navigation. And they called it Bark Shanty. Okay, today we're here to move the Bark Chaney House. It's been a 10-month long project. We're so happy it's actually happening. It really is remarkable that it's happening because we had to line up with so many different organizations, DTE, Comcast, AT&T, the Village of Port Sanilac, Pulaski Building Movers, all these entities and organizations had to be on board to make this happen. And it's actually happening today.
Just made it. Thank you.
I need a little bit of light, so I can't see the switch for the microphone. Oh, I got it. Hello? Yeah, I got it. So, Gene, is there anything you want to add to?
No, I accept that.
Oh, okay. With no hesitation, huh? Okay. And it was really tricky. I assume they knew what they were doing. I'm sure they know what they were doing. Sometimes on something like that, I would have suggested they cut off the rear part of that. Because obviously that was added on at some point, so it should be pretty easy to take it apart and put it back together again. The next one is kind of interesting. Jerry Marion, he was a longtime camera club member, or a photographer. No, it was a camera club back then. And on the board for a long time. And one of the things he enjoyed doing was creative photographs and also working up programs with his photography. And he left the area maybe 2 years ago, but he left behind maybe about 15 CDs with me for programs. So even though Jerry is not here, he will be with us forever. So let's take a look at what he has here. Thank you. I believe Jerry's in one of the Dakotas right now, and I don't know how to pass along our thanks to him, but if anyone emails or texts him, tell him thanks. The next one, Daryl here. You want to say anything about the owls in your backyard? That counts.
They still
Yeah, thanks. And Daryl, by the way, is a new contributor to Showtime. And we hope to see additional programs from you. So this is really fascinating. Right one.
When I gave my heart to a tinker boy, he said a fish could love a swallow, and I will go with my traveling wherever he knows I will follow. He will mend your pots and your kitchen knives, he'll take and sharpen, and I'll be gone with my traveling, and never more your doorway darken. The fish and the bird who fall in love will find no place to build a home in. The fish and the bird who fall in love are bound for where to go on. I'm feeling to go wrong.
What a nice advertisement for the club at the end. Wow. Hey, Daryl, that was great. And I'm sure it took a long time to get those photographs. And I felt a little bit sorry for that guy that was taking a trip. another new contributor is Mike O'Brien. Is Mike here? Is there anything Mike would like to say about this river trip?
answer one question before it gets asked. Near our hotel in Berlin was a big concert, and we see these people rolling in, carrying tables, chairs, bathrooms. They are all dressed in white. We're going, what is going on here? Well, in 1988, Paris, a guy wanted to have his dinner for friends of his in the public area, and he didn't tell them when or where to pay the event, and in order for everyone to identify themselves, he had them all dressed in white. And we just came across this in Berlin, a worldwide phenomenon. The 30th anniversary of Paris, about 5 years ago, I believe, there were 7,500.
Mike, thanks for your contribution. And by the way, you said you had another one you're going to send me, right?
I do.
Okay. Okay, good. A reminder.
There are visions that will blow wings, the rivers of thundering. There are fires that we slide to, there's the sound of the sun. Through the night, in the velvet of the darkness, by the sea to silence, they are watching, they are waiting, they are waiting to life's mystery. Through the night, through the night. Cascading stars on the slumbering hills, they are dancing as full as the sea. Riding on the land, you can feel its gentle hand leading on to its destiny. Thank you. Take me with you on this journey, where the boundaries of time will melt us. In cathedrals of the forest, in the wells of the tongues lost, find the answers, ask the questions, find the wounds Take me dancing, take me singing, I'll ride on to meet the sea. Through the night.
I wonder if they get the backlights turned on. I've got just a couple more short ones. Mike, that was fantastic. Such super excellent photographs. And I can't wait to see your next one. By the way, at the end of Daryl's, he had a nice little advertisement there for the photography club. And what he was referring to is the multimedia SIG. That's where he learned some tips and how to improve his program. And if you want to know how to do stuff like this, that's a good place to start. I've got a couple more things here. This one is particularly directed toward, well, you guys, senior citizens. Maybe you've seen it before. Good show for old people, right? And one more really, really short thing I'd like to share with you.